Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Cornerstone this morning. Would you stand with us as we sing our opening song? Father, thank you so much for being a God worthy to be praised. God, when I ask you for things, when we ask you for things, God, thank you for giving us the answer that we need, not the answer that we always want. God, when you say no, help me to be joyful. God, when you say wait, help me to be joyful. God, when you say yes, help me to be joyful. In your name I pray. Amen.
When I
7. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you.
Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Hey kids, have you ever wondered what heaven is like? Where everything is made of clouds and angels in big white robes singing all the time.
Did you know the Bible gives us an even better idea of what heaven is like?
In the last book of the Bible called Revelation,
the Apostle John gets a special vision of heaven.
And at one point, he sees a scene that must have looked like a movie.
Jesus getting ready for a final battle. Let's take a look.
Jesus is riding a strong white horse. Back in the old days, leaders of armies would charge into battle with a horse. So it's clear that Jesus is going into battle.
Did you know that Jesus has fought for us before?
He fought for us when he died on the cross to save us from our sins.
Even though he's really powerful, he made himself weak so we can be with him.
But this time it's different. He's coming in his full power. Jesus is called faithful and true.
Kids, do you have a nickname? Maybe people call you Flash because you're super fast.
Usually people's nickname tells you a lot about that person. And Jesus' nickname tells you a lot about him.
He's called faithful and true because he always keeps his promises and always tells the truth. The armies of heaven follow Jesus.
In the vision, John sees a big army following behind Jesus.
Can you imagine that? A huge army, and Jesus is the leader.
Did you know if you follow Jesus, you will be in that army? Pretty cool, huh?
We get to fight alongside Jesus, our king. Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
While all this is happening, Jesus is wearing a special robe that helps us know what's going on. Memory verse.
On his robe was written this title, King of all kings and Lord of all lords. See, that's what this story of Jesus is all about.
There might be a lot of kings and there might be a lot of lords, like bosses and stuff. But Jesus is the king and the lord.
So kids, when you think about heaven, remember this, it's not about clouds and angels.
It's about Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Thank you, worship team. And I agree. Thank the Lord for every drop of rain we've had. I want to first of all just give you a report. Those of you who did know and have been praying for me, I went back Thursday for my follow-up cystoscopy, and I'm so very grateful. The doctor said there's no indication of any more cancer, that they got it all. And so it's been gone. So I praise God for that. That's the second report. So I celebrate that. Let me just throw in a note before I get started. You mentioned, Stan, did you call a new member training or membership training class? Let me throw in a plug there. When I pastored almost 29 years before I got into the whole denominational work, I would do a membership training class. I first called it new member, and then I changed it to membership training because that is designed to do three things. Number one, for those who are just curious, like what's going on. The second one would be those who have felt led of the Lord that I do need to become a part of or a member of the church. The third group is for those who are already a member of the church, may have been for 10, 15, or 20 years, but you don't feel comfortable in knowing how to explain to other people what the church really believes about some of these basic foundational things. So it's for those who are just beginning to seek, for those who are ready to move forward, and those who are already Christians and maybe already members of the church for a long time. So what it does, it brings you into one common mindset. And boy, that is extremely significant and important. Even in a home, a man and wife need to be pretty close to the same page. I couldn't honestly say we always are, but Brenda's trying to get there with me most of the time. But it works a lot better when we are on the same page, right? And it works a lot better if we could, those that are looking at, those who are ready to move forward, and those who already are a part of the church, if you would be a part of that also, because You may have questions to clear it up so that when you present to people, we're all presenting basically the same idea and the same report. Or otherwise, you have people going in 19 different directions, and then it's hard to come together. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll move right into the message. Before I get there, though, I think, did somebody adjust that clock? I like it the way it is now. No, it's okay. Leave it there. It says it's 15 to 11. So we've got all kinds of time. First time I've had that much freedom in this church, I'll tell you. Just to preach as long as you want to preach. So, worship team, you just take a rest or something, and we'll be back later, all right? Let's pray. Father, thank you today for the glorious opportunity to come into this building to sing, to pray, just to shake hands, to exchange a few hugs, and now to ask that your Spirit would be our teacher. Lord God, that you'll bring us before you, that we might hear what you have to say to us. Our answer would be yes, Lord, as you make it clear to us. We will come alongside and work together following your leadership. Father, for the many prayer requests that were voiced in this room this morning, and for those that were not even voiced, God, I pray that you will meet those needs in the manner in which you can. We ask you to do two things. We ask you to bring glory to yourself and encouragement to those that are being prayed for. We yield to you today in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You remember last time I spoke with you was been August 1st, and my topic at that time was living in godly fellowship. And that was just before we had the Lord's Supper, we had communion. I want to follow that a little bit further today, and I did not have any idea about this class that's going to be offered, so I'm offering my own class today, just a one-shot deal for 20, 30 minutes, and then you can go from there. My title today would be The Joys and Responsibilities of Being a Local Church Member. And I want to begin by reading an introduction from a pastor named Sam Rainer that wrote in 2013, because it aligns with what I believe, what I understand. But if I just read through my message today, you would say, yeah, he just sort of pointed his finger at us or me or whatever. But when you read what someone else has written 8 years ago first, and then I'll go ahead and develop that as we move on through. Here's what Pastor Rainer had to say. Local churches are like families. Some are healthier than others. All have issues. Unfortunately, many churches are suffering from a serious case of consumerism. The cultural norm of too many congregations has become, how can you serve me rather than how can I serve Christ and others? But I believe many pastors and church leaders are to blame as much as their flocks. We pastors simply have not done a good job of communicating up front what we expect of church members. I have a high view of church membership, and I certainly want to echo that for me. I have a strong view of church membership. I'm a part of the human race, but I am also a Canadian citizen. I'm not just a human at random all over the world. I'm a Canadian. And so I also am a Christian, but I have a strong, high view of church membership. And I hope that I can lead any church that I have ever pastored to have the same view. As we assimilate new people into the body of Christ, the goal is to maintain a culture of high expectations of every church member. I believe the best starting point for setting these expectations is a new member class. Whatever descriptor you use for the class, whatever time slot you choose to teach the class, every new member class should communicate three key points about their church. Number one, information, doctrine, and expectations. Information gives new people an idea of the basics of your church, about staff, about worship style, about ministry philosophy, and where the washrooms are located. Doctrine lets people know up front what you believe. You can no longer assume people understand historical denominational differences. Additionally, Churches within the same denomination in the same town can be quite different now. Don't surprise people. Don't downplay doctrine. Don't confuse people. Be clear about what you believe and who you are. Expectations are often neglected when we're communicating with potential new members. After all, we don't want to scare them away with a stack of sign-up sheets. But I believe the lack of clarifying expectations on the front end of membership is one of the main reasons why we're encouraging an unhealthy culture of consumerism in the church. So, what should you expect of new members? He listed seven. I'm only going to use the six things that I believe. I've listed the seven expectations I teach in my church's new member class. You join the church to sacrifice for the mission of God, and all churches should be clear about how they accomplish this mission. Set the expectations up front, and you'll likely see fewer people with a consumer mentality. Now, that's what Pastor Rainer said, and so you can hear where he's at, and you'll hear where I'm in alignment with him. So, again, I'm going to change the title maybe a little bit, Privileges and Responsibilities of Any and All Church Members. Pastor Rainer teaches these few things, and I'm going to pick out the ones. The verse that I'm going to use as an umbrella today was the last verse that we used August 1st. That was in Acts chapter 2, verse 46 and 47. I hope you'll take a few notes because, you know, when you put hours and hours into a message and nobody takes any notes for anything, unless your brain's better than mine, I've got a bad leak. My cells go through really bad. So I hope you'll take a few notes. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, note 47, and praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Let me give you a clarification on that last verse. You'll notice that there is a difference in being saved and being added to the church. Do you notice that there? He says, and the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Now, there is the term of the universal church, which I very seldom use that because of some hundred and whatever terms, times it'll use, the church in the New Testament. 90-something of them refer to the ecclesia, the called out, local assembly of people. Those that you could see, those you shake hands with, those you talk to, that's the assembled ecclesia, the body of Christ called out and assembled. Because you notice here that the Lord was adding to the church such as should be saved. So one clarification, joining the church doesn't save anybody. But once we are saved, then we need to find a church home that we can serve in, that we can pray for each other. You mentioned prayer requests this morning. That was not a noise in a vacuum. You were stating things that when McGregor prayed, McGregor's prayer was representative of all the people in this room as he lifted one common voice to the Lord God, not just McGregor's prayers. He voiced that which you've already voiced. And none of that was to alert God or to inform him or to bring him up to date or get him up to speed. That was to say to him, in this church today, we have this request to lift to you, Lord Jesus. So that's what was happening there. Number one, together we will gather for worship. Together we will gather for worship. Hebrews says, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Not giving up meeting together as some of are the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. I will worship unless there is a clear reason why not. People are expected to attend worship services regularly. With joy, we can come together and worship with the heart, worship with the mind, and worship with the will. I've always said that I should be able to honestly say, 5 years from now, Lord willing, and I'm able, I will be in a public worship service somewhere on the Lord's Day. Let me state that again. That unless I'm providentially hindered to where I cannot, wherever I'm living, wherever my home church is, or whether I'm a guest somewhere, I will be in public worship. Now, that is something that's getting harder and harder, it seems, for people. More people like to come when they feel like it, not when he says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. And I like verse 24 when it says, to spur one another toward. Encourage each other. Spur them on. When you think of spurs to the average cowboy or horseman, he's saying about, I need just a little bit more acceleration. So I'm going to spur my horse a little bit and get a little bit of lunge out of it. So when we spur each other on, that's to get a little more lunge out of it, get a little more into it, move into it a little bit more. Second one, together we will serve. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. That's a great verse, isn't it? God has given us all a gift. You might say, I don't know what mine is. You begin to pray and ask God, God, what do you want me to, how do you want me to serve? What have you equipped me to do? I'm willing to learn. You know, most of us are not born knowing how to do something extremely well. We learn how to do it better and better, don't we? And that's what we do as Christians. We learn better how to serve God. So God created us to serve. He gifted us to serve. He commands us to serve. And every member should find some way to serve. Otherwise, remember what Pastor Rainer said? Otherwise, we're a consumer church. And consumer is not healthy. You can sit on the sidelines in the bleachers. You know, from when I'm in the bleachers, I can really tell a football team or a hockey team where they're making the mistakes. But when I get down on the field or down on the ice and you start playing in the game, it's a lot different, and that's what we're talking about right here. Find some way to serve. Third one, together we will give. 2 Corinthians 9, 7. So, and this is what he says. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Most people will say, all preachers want to talk about is money. You know, we just need more money. I want to tell you something. If today you give $5 to Cornerstone Baptist Church, you are throwing your money away. If you give $5 to David Thompson Bible Camp, you're throwing your money away. If you give $5 to the Gideons, you're throwing your money away. Here's why I say that. We don't give to the church, to the Gideons, to anything. We give to the Lord Jesus Christ and the expansion of his glorious kingdom through the church, through the camp, through the Gideons, through any way you give. Because if you're giving to the church, that is an end within itself, right? You're giving to the Lord Jesus Christ through the church. So when you're not giving anything, you're just telling God, God, you really don't deserve anything more from me. You got enough. After all, you own the cattle on 1,000 hills. That's very true, but he said, I need a little participation from you because I expect that to show your love. Malachi chapter 3 and verse 8. I want to read that from two different translations. The first one, New King James, says, will a man rob God? Yet you've robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. Tithe in the Hebrew means one-tenth. It just means tenth. So what does that mean? Tithes, one-tenth, go to the general budget for local church expenses, for utilities, for your monthly missions giving commitments, to salaries, to the women's ministries, the youth ministry, the men's ministry, the children's ministries. So we give for that reason. Offerings, and maybe said tithes and offerings, you rob me tithes, above and beyond your monthly or weekly tithe. That's offerings. And we don't give offerings first. We have an accountability to God to tithe to him through our home church. Example of offerings would be what we give to the Gideons, what we give to David Thompson, what we give to capital building improvements, what we give as gifts to someone in town that has a fire, they burn out or whatever. Those are offerings. Those are offerings that we give. And most of the time, those are not tax receivable. A tithe that's given to God through the church, at least quote today, is still taxable. And here's what it says in the New Living Translation. Should people cheat God? Yet you have cheated me. But you ask, what do you mean? Where did we ever cheat you? You cheated me of the tithes and offerings due to me. A verse here that when I found this, I want to tell you, it really scared me. This was probably in 1975 or 6 that I first discovered this verse. Leviticus chapter 27, verse 31 says, whoever would redeem any of their tithe must add a fifth part of the value to it. In other words, if you decide, I'm not going to tithe, then whatever you're holding back from your tithe, you owe God 20% interest on it. You know, we think interest is bad. Start tallying that up a little bit. Get a little bit behind on it. And he said, you've robbed me on tithes and offerings. You cheated me by holding back tithe. But if you want to do that, that's okay. But just remember, we pay back 20% interest. Counts up pretty fast. Number four. Somebody will have to flag at me because I don't have my phone out here. Man, card that, I got 4 minutes. We're not going to make it. Together, we seek unity. 1 Corinthians 1:10 says, now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. So we're working hard at finding common things that we can agree on, that we can worship on. Don't ever try to figure out where all do we differ. It won't take you very long to figure that out, right? Because as I've said before, the old gentleman set a card to my thinking, which is right. But not everybody thinks like I do, but we are going to come together. And we're going to seek God, and we're going to seek unity together. Notice the last word that's in that verse. Again, there were times in my life that I struggled with this. I think I've got a bit of a grip on it now. When he said, and in the same judgment. There's a common statement that floats around today. I don't like to be judged. Don't judge me. I don't judge people. Notice, if you will, in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 12, in the New Living Translation, it says, it isn't my responsibility to judge outsiders, but it certainly is your responsibility to judge those inside the church who are sinning. Do this very cautiously, I would say. But we do have a responsibility, according to this scripture in the Bible, that we are to judge within the church building, within the church family, within the church body. Because if you don't, you can begin to slip and slide, and you slip and you slip and you slip a little bit more, a little bit more. And this is not a judgmental, like, I'm going to condemn you. It's like we're just together trying to keep the body of Christ pure. We're trying to keep focus on the Lord Jesus Christ and His Lordship in the church. And together, number five will be together, we sacrifice. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says, so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all He has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind He will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship Him. I've had people say to me, oh, when you're really walking with the Lord, you're never sacrificing for Him. Everything is just, it's just sort of easy and natural. And I want to tell you something. If you don't ever sense that you're sacrificing anything for the Lord Jesus Christ, you need to launch out a whole lot deeper. You need to get out past the last buoy. You need to get out yonder further. You are never feeling it coming, draining you, coming out of you, that you're just laying it all down. You need to get out deeper, because that's where the joy is. The joy in serving God is not at the shallow. It's when you go deep with Him. And some of that will be called sacrifice. But that's where the joy lies, in sacrificing, giving your life completely to the Lord Jesus Christ. The last one, together we will pray. All members should pray corporately, privately, and publicly. First one, pray corporately. is in Acts chapter 12 and verse 12. When this had dawned on him, he, Peter, went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. That's praying corporately. Like when we come together, we pray together. Our hearts and our souls should run together. We should feel each other's love. We should feel each other's concern. We should feel each other's compassion because we're praying corporately. This is the body of Christ praying. I want to tell you, all you have to do is just mash your little finger a little bit when you're hammering a nail, and the whole body feels it, right, doesn't it? I mean, you ache all over. That's the way it's supposed to be when you're praying corporately. These prayer requests that came this morning, again, they're not a noise in a vacuum. They're to say, I'm feeling this today. Will you feel it with me? I'm concerned for this person. Will you be concerned with me? I'm rejoicing for what happened at camp. Will you rejoice with me? That's praying corporately. You can't do that really as well as you can when you're in a body of Christ where you know that guy loves me even though I may be old and I may be white-headed. They still love me. That's corporately. We need to be praying privately. Matthew 6:6 says, but you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. That is an amazing verse. We're just loaded with revelation. We could just spend the day there. Go and pray privately, and your God that you're praying to and praying and talking with will reward you openly. I want to tell you, you don't beat your own drum to get everybody to recognize you and hear you and think great of you. If you want to do what is right in God's sight, just go to the closet, pour your heart out to Him. Be honest with Him. Don't play stupid little head games with God. When you need to pray and you're praying privately, that's the time that you need to open your soul and just let it all out. God, I am so tired and weary today. I have had the kind of summer that, God, I am hurting. I'm almost mad at you. You know, I found that that's okay in the Psalms. David did that lots, didn't he? Boy, he said, God, why is it that those wicked people, everything they touch, it turns to money, and everything I touch, the wheels fall off. I don't like it. I'm unhappy. But the bottom line was, God said, David's a man after my own heart, because at the bottom, at the end of the day, as we would say, God was foremost in his heart and in his life. We need to pray publicly. Acts 16:25. Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening. That's not either or, praying publicly or privately or corporately. It's all of them at the same time. There's a time that you don't need anybody to hear your prayer, just you and God need to talk. You need God to talk directly to you, not the body, to you. And here is what he's saying now about praying publicly. He said, and the other prisoners were listening. I don't critique people's prayer, but let me tell you something. McGregor, I listened to every word you prayed this morning. I hope you did. Because McGregor did a great job of lifting the requests that were voiced in this room. That's praying. He's the one representing your prayer request and my prayer request, and he's doing his best to be transparent and deliver that message to God. Not that God needed the information, but McGregor needed to be accurate in bringing together the request of this room. I believe that he prayed a good prayer. Not to critique, but yes, did I listen? I definitely listened. There are times when it's not easy being a church member. And neither was it easy for Jesus to provide his plan of salvation for me. But I'll tell you, there are many times when I am so thankful to be a part of a local church family, to be a part of the visible body of Christ. Because when I walk in the room, I know those folks have got my back. If you can't believe that, something needs to be changed. I want to believe that when I come down that step and I stagger up these steps, I want to believe that you've got my back. You are praying to the same God that I prayed to before I got here. People might say, well, God's dead. No, he's not dead, because I talked to him just before I came up here. He's alive and well. When the Lord moved Brenda and me from pastoring this church, this was the last church I pastored, he took us to Cochrane. And now today, we're members of the Bow Valley Baptist Church. Sorriest they've got. The last time we were there was the last Sunday of May, I guess. The first Sunday we'll be back there will be the 19th of September because of ministry. But again, we know where our home church is. We know the number of people that send us texts and emails to say, DK, we're praying for you. Yesterday, I had people, when I was doing that service at the Shaw Complex yesterday for Les Dye, full complex. I mean, the room was full. You think you don't need the Spirit of God to lead and guide you there? Oh, yes, you do. Because there's not a high percent of people in there would say they're strong believers in Jesus Christ. But the text that I got, people saying, we're praying for you. An older lady last night prayed for you today. Pray that it went well. That's what it's like to be a part of the family of God in a visible setting. Oh, yes, we've got brothers and sisters in Afghanistan, in Cuba today, in Haiti today, where their president was assassinated, where they had another big earthquake. Boy, they're hurting. They're hurting like crazy. And we're praying for them. But I want to tell you, there's something about it when we come into this room and the people who identify as Cornerstone Baptist Church. You're it today for us. We're in this today together. Here would be the last three statements that I want to close with. And it comes out of a verse that I used on August 1st. We're going to close today with these three steps. All three steps are mentioned in Acts 2 and verse 41. He said, receive his word. That's confess our sin, repent, ask for forgiveness. Follow in biblical baptism, buried with him. And the third one says, and he added to the church. I encourage you to take what we've said from God's word. Every one of these, you'll notice, were not just my thought. They're all supported on a biblical foundation. When we try to state our beliefs and our views without a biblical foundation, we're just blowing smoke. We need to be based on the word of God, and then don't be afraid to preach it, teach it, and live it. You are a part of the family of God. I am a part of the family of God. But you may be or could be a part of Cornerstone. I can't be a member of two churches at once, and that's where we live most of the time in Cochrane, so they're the ones that are stuck with us. Let's pray, and then worship team, you come and lead. And then after they've led, stand if you'll come, lead in prayer, and close for us today. Father, we bow before you today. What a joy and privilege it is to come into this place designated for public worship. God, thank you for the songs that have been sung. Thank you for the children's little video. Lord, thank you for your word that's so clear. God, I pray that you'll be with Kurt and others who help put together the study for membership in this church. God, may it be biblically accurate. May it be that which we can get our hold of, we can sink our teeth in, and we can share with the world. This is who we are representing King Jesus. Father, I pray that we will really take a good look in today's world at our tithes and offerings. God, there's so many things vying for every dollar we've got. But Lord, you said that you've robbed me of tithes and offerings. You cheated me because you didn't give me what you owed to me. God, if we've done that, forgive us. Help us to catch hold right now and then move forward in your name. We love you, Jesus, but we are so grateful that you love us more. In your name we pray. Amen.
Isaiah 53, verse 3-6. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Thank you, everyone, for coming this morning. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, DK, for the message this morning. I'm thinking of that song, "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood." It's good to be a part of the family of God this morning. And this morning, if God has spoken to your heart and you want to find salvation, you want to understand that Jesus went to the cross to take away our sin and pray, come and see us after the service, and we'll pray with you. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for the wonderful gift that you've given us to be together as your church, as your people. And Lord, help us to take from here, go from here, and see what you are calling us to do. Father, we pray. Thank you so much. We pray for, Lord, just safety as we travel home. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.